Welcome to the Hour of Grace with Apostle Mark Mwanza of Ebenezer, the Hope City Ministries. We are glad you joined us in the Word today. Be blessed.
From Ebenezer, the Hope City Ministries, it's just a wonderful privilege to be with you again tonight, just to share the Word of God and just to edify ourselves and just feast on the richness of God's Word. The Bible says that by the stirring of milk, you produce butter. And I pray that tonight we shall receive the cream of the Word of God, the fatness therein, that we may be enriched in His Word, standing firm on His Word to await the manifestation of the promises that He has given to each one of us. I greet everyone who has tuned in, Lusaka, Kasama, Mongu, Siavonga, all the surrounding areas. You are welcome to the Hour of Grace. It's your brother again, Apostle Mark Mwanza. Tonight, I just want to share with you from the book of 1 John. The book of 1 John. I'll just read a few scriptures, and I pray that God will give us the grace to adequately do justice to the topic tonight. But the emphasis is from the whole book of 1 John. The book has three themes within it, which are love, life, and light. Love, life, and light. But the depth of it is, the central theme is the aspect of fellowship. The aspect of fellowship. We take our first reading from the book of 1 John, chapter 1, and verse number 5. The Bible reads, "This then is the message which we have heard of Him, declare unto you that God is light. In Him is no darkness at all. God is light. In Him there is no darkness at all." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 1 John chapter 4 and verse number 8, the Bible says, "He that loveth not knoweth, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love." 1 John chapter 3 and verse 18, 1 John chapter 3 and verse 18, the Bible says, "My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth." Father, I just want to thank you for your word tonight. I lift up this hour, this program, this platform to you. May you manifest yourself in a dimension that we have never encountered before. May you take us to a depth that we have never been before. May you keep us in this truth that we are about to receive tonight. May every door that needs to open, open. May every door that needs to close, close. May every soul that needs to be saved tonight under your grace be saved. Not by might, nor by power, but by your Spirit. In the name that is above every other name, we give thanks and we give praise. In Jesus' name, amen. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Bless the word and the name of the Most High God. In life, or when it comes to the aspect of Christianity, the aspect of Christianity is never divided on the aspect of denomination. Christianity, in as much as we may have denomination, there are things that are enshrined within the Word of God, enshrined by a word called doctrine. A word called doctrine. I believe that many of you have heard people talk about doctrine, right doctrine, It is the doctrine of God. It is the doctrine of this and the doctrine of that. And sometimes there's no definition of what doctrine is. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16 that all of God's word is inspired, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction and instruction. In the simplest terms, looking at time, doctrine in the simplest term can be defined as what is right. Doctrine is what is right. Reproof is what is not right. Correction is how to get it right. And instruction is how to stay right. So tonight, I just want for a little time just to stand on this word called doctrine. What is right? Hallelujah. There are many ways and many things that we may never agree with. But there are certain things that never change. Whether you are in Zambia, whether you are in Congo, whether you are in America, whether you are in Senegal, wherever you are, there is what is right according to God. What is right according to God? For example, before he enshrined and gave unto the children of Israel the Ten Commandments, where there was a commandment that said, do not murder. When Cain murdered his brother Abel, it was a God who knows what is right, who brought Cain to book before the law was given. Because to God, sin is sin, law or not. Or whether law is given or before the law, sin is sin. Because that is how God is intrinsically. He is a righteous God. So what is right with God is right with him. And what is wrong, whether you are in the law or not in the law. Hallelujah. So there are certain things about God that are right. Hallelujah. Whether you are in this denomination or whether you are not in that denomination, there are certain things that are right by God. For example, there are things about the gospel, about the kingdom. For example, I can say marriage is not between two people. I'll say that again. Marriage is not between two people. Marriage is between a man and a woman. Marriage is for a husband and a wife, a man and a woman. Therefore, the doctrine that encapsulates marriage is not saying that marriage is between two people. It says marriage is between a man and a woman. For example, every Christian fraternity, every Christian congregation must believe that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Every Christian gathering, every Christian believer, wherever they are, they must believe in the aspect of resurrection. Because according to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul declared that our faith becomes futile if we choose not to believe in the aspect of resurrection. He says that our faith or our belief makes us the most pitiable people on earth. So there are certain things that no matter where you are, they are right not because of denomination. They are right because of the God of that denomination. Hallelujah. Or the God of our belief, who is Jehovah, the Most High God, El Shaddai, Elohim. Hallelujah. Blessed be the word of the Lord. I'm trying to rush because I'm sure you have noticed that today we started a little bit late. So just bear with me as I'm trying to speed up a little bit so that I can give out as much as possible what God has laid upon my heart. Hallelujah. So when we talk about truth, sanctify them with your truth. When we talk about truth, we are talking about doctrine. It's only doctrine that makes us to stand in the truth. Because if you remember a while back, I said you can recover from a false prophecy. Not a false prophet. A false prophecy, a fake prophecy about you. You can recover from it. What may take you time to recover from is a false doctrine. A false doctrine. Where instead of having belief in Jesus, let me give an example of myself quickly as we move tonight. There was a time where the only thing I believed could set me free was not Jesus. There was a time that I believed that the only thing that could set me free was deliverance and more deliverance and more deliverance and seeking more deliverance. And when I leave this one deliverance meeting, I'm still looking for another highly anointed man who flows in deliverance and more deliverance. I don't know if you're following me. It is the same bag that catches people who always just want prophecy and more prophecy and more. You can never just get it. It's a false doctrine that moves you away from the concept of truth and brings you into a bondage to keep thinking that unless you go and see a particular man or a particular woman or attend or visit a church that flows in either deliverance or prophecy, there is no need for you to go there because you believe that the only thing that can set you free is deliverance or more prophecy. And yet the Bible said that you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. So there is a doctrine where we can stand on the truth and be liberated. There is a place for deliverance, ladies and gentlemen. But there is another deliverance called the ignorance that does not go out by the casting or by the laying on of hands. It goes out by the pouring in of wisdom, by the pouring in of knowledge, by the developing within yourself what we call an understanding. You need to understand what this kingdom is, but you can never understand the functionality of the kingdom of God if you don't know the truth of the kingdom. The truth of the kingdom, because it's those truths that set you free. Now, a lot of time, doctrine is always emphasized on the aspect of preaching, which is fine, but that is a myopic view of doctrine. Hallelujah. Doctrine. The word doctrine. Hallelujah. Doctrine must also encapsulate what you believe. Your belief must be centered on the truth. Doctrine also must encapsulate on the songs that are sung in the church. Because there is no way, if a preacher is not permitted to preach false doctrine, that a singer will be permitted to sing false songs. Hallelujah. I remember a time, I was in a certain meeting a long time ago. And the first time I heard this song, and it really just made me feel very uncomfortable. And I heard the people shout, "Donsa Mapalo, Donsa, Donsa." I said, "What is going on in this place?" So if a preacher has no right to preach what is wrong, a singer, a worshiper, a minister of song and psalms and hymns has no right to construct, to develop songs that are wrong. I hope you are following me tonight. Now, encapsulated in the aspect of doctrine, there are certain fundamental things that every believer needs to have within them. The first fundamental thing within doctrine is the aspect of epistemology. Hallelujah.
Epistemology is when you study the knowledge to understand or find out the integrity of design. When you begin to study the Bible and begin to look at its design, thereby when you see the design, you begin to understand that there is integrity within this word that I'm studying. Because from Genesis up to Revelation, I can see a design. I can see that within the design there is an integrity. There is no lapse within the design. Therefore, it is a knowledge that I can take. It is a knowledge I can rely on. It is a knowledge I can apply. It is a knowledge that I have seen, not only from reading it, but I can also experience, have an experiential encounter with the word. Hallelujah. So for example, when Jesus resurrected, the Bible says he was walking on the road to Etimias or Emias or something like that, one of those towns away from Jerusalem. And he found two people talking about the things that happened in Jerusalem. They did not know that he was the one who was walking with them. And they began to tell him what happened. And then he began to tell them, say, "You fools. Did you not know that I was to suffer many things?" And then the Bible says he began to teach them from Moses. Which means that Jesus began to authenticate the message. Not only about himself, but the message of the Bible. He began to authenticate certain people who wrote certain books in the Bible. For example, he says, beginning at Moses, meaning begin to look from Genesis all the way to Deuteronomy. And then he also spoke about Jonah. He also endorsed Isaiah, Elijah. He endorsed a lot of prophets. Why? Because he was trying to emphasize that, look, this information that is being given to you, you can study its integrity. Remember, there's a time he met the Pharisees and he said, if you really understood what you were reading, you would know that the scriptures talk about me. We are talking about the integrity of the design. The integrity of the design. Why do a lot of people read the word and not rely on it? It's as though they found lapses. As though the word has become obsolete. So now we need a new nice gospel to preach it and package it in another way. Why? To make it have relevance. No. It doesn't need to be packaged in any other way except the package of truth. I hope I'm communicating something tonight. Epistemology. So Jesus said, not even a jot or a tittle shall be taken away from my word. In other words, it is constructed, the engineering of the word of God is such an integral and has integrity in its fiber that if you remove a comma, if you remove a letter, the whole fabric and the whole meaning of the text begins to fall apart. That's why he said you must not add or subtract, because there is an integrity within its design, beginning from Genesis chapter 1 and verse number 1. Epistemology. Even the numbers that are found within the text, within the context, they all have meaning and relevance. That's why there is also what they call the theology of numerology. Epistemology. Every believer, every born again believer, every child of God must know how to rely on the word of God. Not because it's called the Bible, but because you have tried its integrity. Epistemology. Then within the aspect of doctrine, there is another thing that we want to call apologetics. Now, when we talk about apologetics, a lot of people want to relate apologetics to debating. You know, debating, especially when it comes to Christian scholars versus Muslim scholars. They when they meet to debate and people say apologetics. But you need to understand one thing, because apologetics is the defense of your faith. If you are a believer, and you cannot answer truthfully why you believe, your walk will always have problems. If you cannot defend why you believe in Jesus Christ, your walk will always have problems. Because apologetics is not just for debate. It's also for your defense. If I were to ask you, if you were to ask me, brother ABCD, why do you believe? I must then stand on the truth by which I have, through epistemology, discovered an integrity to the word of God, and I stand upon it, and by it I have built my belief to stand, to believe, to share, even to defend and be ready to die for it. It is called apologetics. You must be able to defend and to tell people why you believe. Don't tell people what church you go to. Some of those people you tell what church you go to is the reason why they are not going or haven't believed. Tell the people why you believe in Jesus. Defend. Can you truly defend? Can you truly, truly, truly stand and tell people why you believe? Can you give an account as to why you believe? You can only do that when you are a person who is enshrined in doctrine. What is right? You have stood on the truth. You have studied the truth. I hope I'm communicating tonight. Now, doctrine isn't this. There are many things. There are many things within the body of Christ which are wrong, which have been imported, which have been imitated, many things that are being done without question, without biblical support. And just because there are many people doing those things, it doesn't make it a doctrine. A wrong doesn't become right by virtue of majority. I hope I'm communicating tonight. There are things that are wrong in the body of Christ. Not because we serve a wrong God. Sometimes it's interpretation. Sometimes it is the seed of the serpent who has, because the Bible says, no marvel, because even Satan masquerades as an angel of light and false apostles and so on and so forth. Because what, the people can come into the congregation and then begin to infiltrate the congregation and begin to make something look popular. That's why Paul said, in Corinthians, I did not come to you with persuasive words, with fluency of speech, with fine words and fine grammar. You know, there are certain people when they begin to talk. One time I was listening to some, I'm the person, the way the person was describing favor and even my toes started to believe. But when I checked the message, it was empty. But because the grammar was captivating. Grammar doesn't make doctrine. Truth makes doctrine. That's why don't worry about how I pronounce words, how I'm stammering. Those things, truth is what enshrines doctrine. Do you know the truth? Even your situation, where you are now, everything about you is only to the extent of the truth you have exposed yourself to. Everything you are saying is taking long. There is a delay. When you stand on the platform of truth, you begin to declare a certain confession that is contrary to what you had before you stood on the platform of truth. So there is a man called Job. Having been afflicted, affliction did not represent where he stood, but his confession represented where he stood. And because of his confession, the Bible says that his latter end was greater than the former. Job 42 and verse number 10. Because he stood, the affliction did not move him from the platform of truth. Emotions, pain did not move him from the platform of truth. So he declared, I know my... You see, my affliction does not make God dead. Neither does it make him a deaf or dumb or blind. So he says, I know my Redeemer lives. He's not just talking hot air. It's the truth. He knows it. He has stood on it. It's an experiential knowledge that causes him to speak. I know my Redeemer lives. And when he's done with me, he says, I'm coming out as good as gold. When affliction comes upon this church now, people leave church. They are not saying, I'm coming out as good as God. Say, I'm leaving the church. I'm coming out of that church. I'm looking for another church. As if the church is the reason why you are afflicted. You have 3 Bibles in your house. You never read them. You are always relying on someone to feed you. Someone to teach you. Like this, after I finished teaching, I told you I'm giving an exegesis from the whole book of 1 John. Instead of you after to go and study the whole book of 1 John, you are going to say, that was good preaching. Ah, he didn't do it justice. I didn't even understand the thing. That's why I attend the radio. And you are wondering why there are certain things you are supposed to overcome. You haven't overcome them because the truth is yet to be in you. And truth is not knowledge. Truth is a person. I am the way, the truth, and the life. It's a person. But it's another dimension of Jesus. Just like light is another dimension of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Doctrine. So now, getting into the word for tonight. We said there are 3 things. Light, love, life. Hallelujah. These things are the fulcrums of fellowship. The fellowship that I have with God. The fellowship that you have with God. Or the fellowship you are trying to build. The concepts are life, love, and light. We can only fellowship with God if we abide in light according to 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 5. We can only fellowship with God if we abide in light. And then we can only produce love if we haven't loved the world. And then life can only manifest if we have chosen truth above false things. See, light exposes and neutralizes darkness. Darkness isn't an equal to light. When light appears, even in the natural, darkness doesn't even say bye-bye. Darkness even doesn't ask to say, do you still want me around? It disappears. See, the ability to live within the aspects of God's power is not just knowing the light, but the ability to separate darkness and light, which is the ability to resist the aspects of the flesh and hold on to the aspects of the spirit, to separate the two. You see, you don't see light, but by light you see everything. I hope you are following me tonight. I said you don't see light, but by light you see everything. Meaning, when the light is in you, you will not see it, but you will see everything. And then light also illuminates, whereby even others are able to see certain things about their life that they are able to change or should take on. Why? Because the light permits people to see. Not to see it, but permits people to see. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to emphasize more on the aspect of love. From 1 John chapter 3 and verse 18. Let me just read it for those who might have just joined us. My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. You see, when it says not in words or not in word, The issue about not loving in word is this. In word, a believer like myself, like you, we can produce kind words, but we fail to produce kind actions. We can produce kind words, but we fail to follow up the kind words with kind actions. And then the Bible says, you must not love in word and in tongue. So meaning, the tongue is able to produce kind words, it does not mean. Because we are going to say something nice, but if we truly believed in what we are saying, we'd back it up with an action. But because we are saying things we don't mean, we say kind words without any action because we didn't mean what we said. So the Bible rebukes us, say, don't love in word and in tongue, but you must love in deed. Because the deed is needed to complete the kind words. Say, you must love in deed and in truth, because truth corrects the insincere tongue, which is able to say things it doesn't mean. Remember, James chapter 3 begins to teach us about the tongue. So truth controls the tongue. Truth controls the tongue so that the tongue never says things it doesn't mean or doesn't say things to harm other people. That's why when you are filled with truth, you can never gossip anybody else. When you are filled with truth, you are always going to stand on the platform where error, you correct error, not because you feel you are big, but because the motive that drives you is truth. One time, Paul entered into Corinth, and he was about to talk to them about a particular thing that he was reported to him. When he entered, you find this story in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 1. When he spoke to them, he didn't say, it has been told to me. He just didn't say this thing, sister. He just didn't say, oh, someone told me that there are bad things happening here. No. He went directly and said, it has been told to me by those who are from the house of Chloe. Meaning, if what I'm addressing now is an issue before you, you will know where it's coming from. Have you ever done a report by truth? Where someone tells you something, you don't go and say, I heard you were talking about me. You also incorporate the reporter. Because you are standing on the platform of truth. You have nothing to hide. Brother so-so said that you were saying A, B, C, D about me. You are standing on the platform of truth. But when there's no truth in you, you are also trying to protect the one who came to report. Without knowing that he's also part of the conspiracy against your life. Hallelujah. What is the act of love towards the brethren? Jesus Christ, or God our Father, does not just call us his children. He makes us his children. That is the aspect of love, the act of love that God has for us. He just doesn't call us things. He actually makes us those things. It's very easy, especially when you come in the Pentecostal circles. A pastor like myself can call people my son, my daughter, and all those things. And you may find that I can call them that, but not treat them what I call them or how I address them. But God addresses us as sons, and he treats us as sons. Meaning, the same love that he would have or had or has for Jesus is the same love that he has for us. That's why when we become born again, we become joint heirs or co-heirs with Christ. I hope I'm communicating something here. Hallelujah. When we are talking about the act of love, we are talking about doing something about other people's needs. You see, fine words don't take the place for fine deeds. You can't replace fine deeds with fine words. Hallelujah. Deeds made at a personal expense. Here is the thing about Christianity. Every Christian must be ready to sacrifice. Self-sacrifice. Every Christian must be ready, because when we talk about love, the very essence of love is enshrined in giving. Because giving, not just money, because I know some people, when you just hear giving, the only thing you think about is money, which you don't even have. But that's a story for another day. When we talk about giving, we are talking about explaining who we are. Hallelujah. We are talking about explaining who we are. So when we are talking about deeds, a man must be ready for the self-sacrifice to manifest the love in deeds. Hallelujah. There is what we call the labor of love, and also the laboring in prayer. You demonstrate love when we meet people at their point of need. Hallelujah. Love and faith have this in common. They both need deeds to prove their reality and genuineness. You cannot genuinely love someone minus the aspect of deeds. That's why the Bible says in the scripture that everyone knows, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Now, here's the thing. When you hear, for God so loved, you think the love and the giving, okay, that's cool. But you don't understand that within that aspect of scripture, there's a word there that shows you that he really loves us. Because there's a word that he says, only begotten son, only. You see, when you only have a pair of shoes, you will treasure it. When you have one wife, you will treasure her. One husband, you will treasure her. One job. I don't know whether you want. When you have one car. When you have one pair of trousers. Hallelujah. When you have one life, only one life, you will treasure it. You will not be careless with it. So when you hear, for God so loved the world that he gave. Oh, okay, that's all right. He gave Jesus. No, it's not just he gave Jesus. It's not like he was doing picking up, picky dolly and who. No, it was the only one that he had. He gave us the best. I hope I'm communicating something tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Love has to be productive. That's why there are certain words. If they could be quantified either into a bag of millimeal or loaves of bread or milk or eggs or money, we wouldn't say them. Like, God bless you. The reason why we say it is because we can't quantify. We can't measure it. But if it could be quantified, say, God bless you. And then there is 5 chickens. And then there is a shopping voucher. Go and take your family. And then there is money for rent for the sister. Money for rent for the single mother. For the widow. Although instead of that. But because we can't quantify it and measure it, we say it without meaning. God bless you. Stay with me tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When we talk about the aspect of truth, these are words that correspond to reality. They must be in accord with divine truth, which is in Christ. Hallelujah. The deeds coming out of love are produced by truth. Are produced by truth. You see, hatred is the character of the world. That's why Cain killed his brother. Because he had within him the character of the world. That inability to change, because God told him, if you do what is right, you will be accepted. But he chose not to do what was right. He chose. Just like you are listening to me tonight, and you can choose to change your ways, to amend your ways, or you can listen to this and say, Father, I thank you for this grace. I pray that I begin to walk in this truth. I begin to walk in the reality of this your word, because I am the light in this place. They will only know the truth of Christ through me, not through the church I go to. If there is something I abhor, if there is something I truly love, it's the aspect of denomination. It has divided and scattered the work. Other people think evangelism is getting people from Catholic Church and Jehovah's and SD, and they come to other people think waking up is when Pentecostal, there are too many things happening. I'm going back to my traditional church. What are you talking about? You think that is truth? Standing on the platform of truth. Is it God or is it God? Say, how long shall you waver between two opinions? If God be God, worship him. But if Baal be God, then go to Baal. You can't waver between two opinions. That's why you are going to find that the aspect of soul winning is a very difficult thing to do. Why? Because we are not truly entrenched in truth. The doctrine of truth, the one that brings about the actions, is not there. We don't evangelize because the church program. We evangelize because God also loved me. I was supposed to perish, but by the love of God, I am saved. And I cannot watch other people perish. Love is a sacrificial thing. But remember apologetics. It's very difficult to go and minister to someone over something that you are also not very sure about. Because if you don't get your car by the end of this year with this COVID, you might just go back to the world. Because the truth is not entrenched in you. Hallelujah. 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 The distinguishing mark of a child of God is love. The distinguishing mark is love. Not tongue. Hey, I'm closing soon. Hallelujah. Not tongues. Not many things. Paul said, if a man speaks in tongues but has not love, is just like an empty symbol. If a man can prophesy, has not love, it's nothing. If he moves mountains, raises the dead, and does so many, without love, he said it means nothing. So the true mark of being a born again, a child of the Most High God, El Shaddai, Elohim, is love. That is the certificate. You don't say, I've been born again since 1923. No. Are you walking in love? You don't say, I'm an apostle. I was called in a trance. I was taken up to heaven. Hey, my brother, are you walking in love? Is the world looking at us and saying, we want to be part of them? Or are we looking at the world and say, I think I need to go back? It is love that causes people within the church to hate one another. I've never seen it before, except in church. Hate one another and lift up their hands like this. But the neighbor, from the time the person sat there, is just thinking, why did the ushers make me sit here? Don't they know I hate this person? Love. Hallelujah. The difference between Satan and God's children. Satan's children hate, murder, and are self-centered. God's children repent from sin, renounce hate, and murderous attitude. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's not duty or obligation. It's the nature. It's the nature of a Christian to love. It's the nature. It is a doctrine. It doesn't matter whether you are in this particular denomination or that denomination or that other place over there. Are you people walking in love? Hallelujah. Are you people walking in love? Is your certificate clear? Because love is the one that presents us before God to know his will. It's not what I desire. It's what the love compels me to do. I don't force people. If you don't receive Jesus, you will die in hell. Oh, don't you know, you sinner. Hey, slow down. It's the love that compels. Can you win people over with love? Hallelujah. I want to close. I have about 1 minute or so. I close. I leave you with my last statement. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I pray that there is something you have received today, tonight, from this program. People, I want to close with this statement. People are not likely to hear us if we only preach to them words. But people may listen to us if they can see that we preach or we are practicing what we preach and not preaching what we are trying to practice. The love of God, the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with everyone who has tuned into the program. Anyone who is saying, I have heard the message, I am compelled and convicted to receive our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. There is no issue of barrier over the radio. The love of God is already there. God is ready to receive you. Write your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. And therein begin to walk in the truth of God. That you are a chosen child of God. Adopted, received in the kingdom. That your sins are forgiven. That by the precious blood that was shed by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, all is wiped away. And you are a new creature in Christ. Therefore now there is none under condemnation. I pray for such a person now, that may the love of God be shed abroad in your heart. May you receive Jesus tonight. May your life turn around from the life of darkness. May your heart be turned towards the precepts of God. May your mind be loose from all the deceiving spirits and voices and thoughts of the world. And may you begin to walk anew. I pray that you find a Bible-believing church near you. I pray that you get entrenched in your word. I pray that you begin to read your word from tonight, starting from 1 John, the whole book, which is 5 chapters. I pray for everyone who tuned in tonight. Under any form of oppression, intimidation, affliction, the love of God, take it all away. For Jesus came to manifest the will of God. And the Bible says he went about doing good. And I pray that by his spirit, good shall manifest in your house to destroy the works of the enemy. In the mighty name of Jesus, the Son of the living God. Where there was division, we command that division to be broken. We command everything that needs to bow. We command every door that needs to open. In the mighty name of Jesus. Every sickness be lifted off you by the anointing of God. This is your brother from Ebenezer, the Hope City Ministries. It's been a great pleasure being with you tonight. Remain blessed. Remain in the faith. Remember, God is faithful. God is overly faithful. And God is faithfully faithful. Remain entrenched in the love of God towards men and all men. Shalom.
Thank you for listening to Hour of Grace with Apostle Mark Mwanza of Ebenezer, the Hope City Ministries. We are located in Avondale on number 9 Eucalyptus Avenue. For more details, contact us on 0967.